Hello all, welcome to Get Into IAS, and in this video we are going to deal with the lesson National Income. So what is called as National Income? See, under this, National Income of a country is the total income generated by the residents of the country in its economic territory in a particular period of time, usually 1 year. So National Income of a country is the total income generated, fine, by the residents of a country. So residents are the people who stay inside the country, right? And that is calculated for a particular period of time, say 1 year. So the national income for 1 year will be calculated. So the growth of the national income helps to know the progress of the country. So the national income of last year will be connected with the national income of this year. So with this, it may help us to know the growth of the country, fine. So there are various methods to calculate national income. But before that, let us learn about the demand and supply in our economy. Basically, the household and the business firms. So before that, we learn the four players in our national income. So there are four players who are contributing to the national income. The first one is the individuals or the household. Second one is the business firms. Third one is the government. And the fourth one is the foreign nationals. For better understanding, we'll take the individual or households and the business firm, the relationship between individuals and the business firm. So over here the demand is given and over here the supply is given. Okay. So take the household. From the household only, we supply labor, land, capital and entrepreneur to the business firms. And how does the business firms repay that? For the labor, wages are paid. For the land, rent is paid. For the capital, interest is paid. And for the entrepreneur, profit is paid. So, for labor, you should pay wages. For the land in which you have set up the business firm, you have to pay the rent. And for the capital that you have borrowed from the bank, you have to pay the interest. And for the entrepreneur, that is the people who put in their brain, you have to give them profit. So, all these are on the demand side. Now, coming to the supply side. The household will consume the products of the business firms and the business firms will produce the goods and service for the households. So the business firms will produce the goods and service that will be consumed by the household. So this is the cycle of our economy which contributes to the national income. Next, coming to the compiling of the national income. So under the national income, we have the income method and the expenditure method or the consumption method. Okay. So under the income method, see over here, the business firms provide what? They provide income to the household in terms of wage, rent, interest and profit. So all these are income. So if you calculate national income based on income, it is called as income method. But come to this side, the business firms are spending for the household. So all those comes under the expenditure method, or the household is consuming these goods and services, or that comes under the consumption method. Okay. Now moving to the methods for national income, methods for measuring national income. First one is the product or value added method. Second one is the income method. And the third one is the expenditure method. So these are the three methods in which national income is calculated. And there are various other methods also to calculate national income. So these are the various other measures. Let's deal with this one by one. So now coming to the GVA at basic prices and GVA at factor cost. Before learning about GDP, let's learn about GVA, gross value added at basic prices and gross value added at factor cost. Okay. So before that, so now let's deal with GVA at basic prices. So what is GVA at basic prices? GVA stands for gross value added. GVA at basic prices is also called as GVA at producer's price. How? See over here, basic price means I have a production unit. Okay. So I am the producer. I am a producer of certain product. So from this company's point of view, you are calculating the gross value added. See, for producing bat, right? For producing a bat, I should give a lot of input like wood, and where there are various other inputs for producing a bat. Like that, in the producer's point of view, if you see, it is called as GVA at basic prices or GVA at producer's price. Okay. So over here, the term basic price is the alternate term to the producer's price. It is different from the market price or the buyer's price. So there are two kinds of price. One is the producer's price. This producer is selling his product, and on the other side you have the market price. So on the market side you have the buyer's price. That is, those buyers are getting the product which is sold by the producer. Fine. So the producer's price is equal to the production cost. The buyer's price is over and above the producer's prices, include product taxes minus the production subsidies. Over here see, the producer's price will be equal to the production cost. Production cost is what all cost has incurred to the producer for creating this bat. That is called as production cost. And then when coming to the buyer's price, always the buyer's price will be more than the producer's price. Okay. See, in case if the same bat is coming to the market, definitely the price of the bat will be more. Okay. So under that, the buyer's price will be equal to producer's price plus product taxes minus production subsidies. See over here, the buyer's price is producer's price. Producer's price, we already dealt with this. What is product taxes? Product taxes is the government will imply tax for this producer. Like he will pay excise duty for this. So this is a kind of tax. So these are the product taxes minus the product subsidies. Government will give subsidy also for this producer, right? So when you minus this, this is called as producer's price. Okay. Now the GVA is arrived from the output of 11 industries. So 11 industries is taken into account and the gross value added of all these 11 industries are taken into account and GVA at basic prices is calculated. See, the output will be equal to input materials and services plus value added. What is the output over here? What is the output over here? That is, what is the output in the producer's point of view? Output is input materials. For example, take in an agricultural field, the input material will be the fertilizers, seeds, plus the pesticides and all these. Plus the services. For example, the transportation. You need to carry those agricultural products from the farm to the mandis, right? All the services will be added, plus the value addition. Value addition in the sense, so in case if those wheat or rice is sold in a market, and then if the wheat or rice is bought by a restaurant, so he is adding some taste to that, and hence he is value adding to that product, and hence the output will be the input materials and the services plus the value addition made to that product. So on the whole, the product will look very nice. That is called as the output. So it will be sold to the final customer through its output, right? Next coming. So to arrive at the gross value added, the intermediate consumption is deducted from the output value. So the formula for GVA at basic prices will be equal to output minus intermediate consumption. We'll see that with an example. See, take an example of a wheat flour. Okay. It is manufactured in industries and is a final product of these industries. So take a industry, wheat industry. It is manufacturing wheat. So wheat is the final product here. Okay, wheat is the final product. So let us take the value of 1 kg of wheat flour at basic price as 80 rupees. So 1 kg of wheat will be equal to 80 rupees over here. Okay, so the output is what? Output is 80 rupees. Okay, the output is what? 80 rupees. And next one, to manufacture wheat flour, wheat and electricity are needed to be used as inputs. So for manufacturing a wheat flour, okay, for wheat flour, you need wheat plus electricity to grind that into flour, to grind the wheat into flour. So wheat and electricity are outputs of other industries. Okay. So wheat is output of agriculture sector. You know, wheat is output of agriculture. Electricity is output of the electricity, gas or water supply and other utility services sector, etc. So they were already accounted as output of the other sectors. But over here, these are the inputs. So in this wheat flour industry, this wheat and the electricity are the inputs. Fine. Hence, they are deducted from the output of manufacturing sector to arrive at the value addition of the manufacturing sector. For example, let us assign the value to the inputs. So, input value of wheat. So, over here, you need wheat for this industry. Input value of wheat is 20 rupees. Input value of electricity is 10 rupees. Okay. Now, let us calculate gross value added by wheat flour manufacturing industry. Now coming to the manufacturing industry, okay. GVA at basic prices will be equal to output minus intermediate consumption. So what is GVA at basic price? Output minus the intermediate consumption. This is the formula, final formula, GVA at basic prices. Output minus the intermediate consumption. So over here, gross value added by wheat flour manufacturing industry will be equal to output of the wheat manufacturing minus input of the wheat flour manufacturing. See over here, the total value is what? See, the value of wheat, 1 kg of wheat is 80 rupees minus, see over here, these are the inputs. That is 20 plus 10 is the input. If you minus this from the total output, the output, total output of the wheat is 80 rupees. So 1 kg of wheat is 80 rupees. But see, the intermediate consumption, these two are the intermediate consumption. That is, this 20 rupees wheat and the electricity 10 rupees. You have to minus it. So total value comes to be 50. So the gross value added at basic price is what? 50. Now coming to the gross value at basic prices, let's decode it again. See, compensation of employees. Compensation of employees means, see, for producing this wheat, you have to pay to the employees. For producing the wheat flour, you have to pay to the employees in your company. That is called as compensation of employees. Plus operating surplus or the mixed economy. Okay. So, what is operating surplus or the mixed economy? See over here, operating surplus or the mixed economy is a measure of surplus occurring from process of production before detecting an explicit or implicit interest charges, rent or other property incomes payable on the financial asset, land or other natural resources required to carry the production. So what you're calculating under the operating surplus or the mixed income? See here, operating surplus or mixed income is a measure of the surplus occurring from the process of production before deducting any explicit or implicit interest charges. See, the company would have got loans from the banks. For that, it should pay the interest. So, before it could pay the interest, there will be an amount. There will be an amount got by selling the wheat flour. So, that also will be calculated under the operating surplus. And then, the rent should be paid for the land, right? So, for the land, rent should be paid. So, that also won't get detected from here. So, the total amount without detecting the interest on the loans and the rent for the land is called as what? Operating surplus or the mixed economy. Fine. So, the surplus so arrived in the case of the incorporated enterprises are called as operating surplus. The surplus arrived in case of unincorporated enterprises are called as mixed economy. So, they are dividing into two, the operating surplus and the mixed economy, right? If it is incorporated enterprises, it is called as operating surplus. If it is unincorporated enterprises, it is called as mixed economy. See over here, what is an incorporated enterprises? Incorporated enterprises refer to the enterprises that are established as a separate legal entity. Okay, they are a separate legal entity. A separate legal entity is an entity which can be treated like a human being. So, how you are treating me, you should treat the incorporated enterprises also the same way. Okay, it is capable of entering into contracts. On failure of its contract, it should be sued in a court. So, you can sue the company in the court. It can borrow from anybody and it has to repay the amount, just like human beings. So the example of incorporated enterprises are companies and limited liability partnership registered under the Companies Act. So all these comes under the incorporated enterprises. So what are unincorporated enterprises? It is the opposite of incorporated enterprises. For example, they are not a separate legal entity. There is no distinction between the owners and investors here. Okay. So all are treated as owners. Examples of unincorporated enterprises are partnership firms. Okay. And next, coming to the consumption of fixed capital over here. What is consumption of fixed capital? For example, for producing the wheat flour, you need a machine, right? You need a machine, right? So this machine will undergo wear and tear as years passes by. So this is called as what? This is called consumption of the fixed capital. This machine is a fixed capital. You are consuming it day by day, month by month, year by year. So you are consuming that machine and it is undergoing wear and tear. So, the formula for consumption of fixed capital is initial value of asset minus the current value of asset. So, initial value of asset will be 100 rupees. So, for 100 rupees, I got the machine. But now, while I'm selling, it is only 50 rupees. Okay. So, initial value minus the current value is called as consumption of fixed capital. So much I have consumed. Next, coming to the production taxes less the subsidies. What is called as production taxes? I already told you all, the producer has to pay a lot of taxes to the government. So all those are called as production taxes less the subsidies, means government will give certain kind of money, help to the producer. Those are called as subsidies. So all this club together is called as GVA at basic prices. Now coming to GVA at factor cost. GVA at factor cost means output minus intermediate consumption minus production taxes minus production subsidies. Okay. So GVA at factor cost will be equal to GVA at basic prices. See, the formula over here is the same except for the last one. That is, over here it is positive. Positive of production taxes less the subsidies. But over here it is negative of the production taxes minus the production subsidies. Okay. So please keep this formula in mind. So next, coming to the production method. So under the production method, the first one is the GDP, gross domestic product. So what is called as GDP? So GDP at market price is equal to the sum of gross value added of all its resident units. See, GDP means, so in India, for 1 year, the GDP will be calculated. So what is GDP in first case? GDP is the gross value added of all resident units. So gross value added, we already dealt with the gross value added of basic prices and market prices. So under the GDP, it is the gross value added at market prices of all the residents inside the country plus those taxes minus the subsidies on the products. So it denotes gross value added plus tax on product minus the subsidies on products. So the GDP at market prices can be calculated as GVA at basic prices. You have to take into account the GVA at basic prices plus the product taxes, including the import duties. Product taxes, you know about the product taxes. Now the import duties is also included inside this product taxes minus the product subsidies. So this is the formula for GDP. Fine. So now coming to the GDP deflator, another important term in economics, what is called as GDP deflator. So GDP deflator is the nominal GDP divided by the real GDP into 100. So nominal GDP is the current year's GDP. Current year's GDP is called as the nominal GDP. That will be compared with the past year's GDP. For example, there is a base year for GDP, right? 2011 and 12. So the GDP on that year is called as real GDP. Into 100 will give you the GDP deflator. How much the GDP has deflated. Fine. So the nominal GDP is the current year. This year's GDP, it will be compared to what? The base year's GDP. Into 100 is GDP deflator. Now coming to the estimates of national income. See, how is national income estimated in India? So the calculation of national income dates back to pre-independence period. Okay, before we could get independence itself, the national income was calculated in India. So this is updated, modified and fine-tuned to changing times. So national income is modified to the present time. Okay, we are not using that calculation as of now. We have changed it. See, before independence, that is in 1868. In 1868, keep this year in mind. In 1868, Dadabhai Nauroji wrote a book named Poverty and Un-British Rule in India. Very important, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India is the book of whom? Dadabhai Nauroji in 1848. So under this, he estimated the per capita income of Indians. So the per capita income, we already dealt with per capita income. The per capita income of an Indian was 20 rupees. So per capita income was 20 rupees. Thereafter, the following persons had also calculated the per capita income. For example, Finlay Shiraz, in 1911, he calculated the per capita income to be 49 rupees. And Wadia and Joshi in 1913 and 14 calculated the per capita income to be 44.30. Okay. So for the period from 1925 to 1929, Dr. VKRV Rao calculated per capita income of Indians to be 76 rupees. So he was the first person to estimate national income scientifically with a proper method. Very important point. Who scientifically estimated the national income? It was Dr. VKRV Rao. So after independence, how are we calculating the national income? See, National Income Committee was formed in 1949. When was it formed? 1949, the National Income Committee was formed. Okay. So under the chairmanship of whom? Professor P.C. Mahanalobis. You would have heard about the very famous Professor Mahanalobis. Okay. So he was the chairman of this National Income Committee. Under this, it submitted its first report in 1951 and the final report in 1954. So first report in 1951, final report in 1954. So under this, it reported that the per capita income was 246.90 for the period 1950 to 1954. So for the period 1950 to 1954, the per capita income was calculated to be 246.90. So later, the Central Statistical Organization was formed. So the first official estimate of CSO was made in 1956 with the base year of 1948-49. So CSO, Central Statistical Office, was created So that estimated our national income. Fine, under this, the base year was 1948 to 49. Okay. See, we have something called as the new series now. New series, okay. So under this, see, the new series of national income was started in January 2015. In January 2015 only, we are starting the new series for the calculation of national income. Fine, with the base year 2011 and 12. So the base year was 2011 and 12. So the old series of GDP at factor cost was called GDP. But now the new series of GDP at market price is called as GDP. So at the old thing, the GDP at factor cost was taken into account. But now we are calculating GDP on the basis of market price. Please keep this in mind. Earlier, the sector-wise manufacturing data on value addition was sourced from the RBI Industrial Outlook Survey. Very important. Sector-wise manufacturing. For example, the manufacturing unit for each sector. Like, we have various sectors under a manufacturing unit. So, the sector-wise will be calculated by RBI under the Industrial Outlook Survey, conducted on quarterly basis. So, quarterly basis will be quarterly 1, 2, 3 and 4. So, for the sector-wise in the manufacturing unit, this is how RBI calculated using the Industrial Outlook Survey. Fine. And the Annual Survey of India. So, totally there were two surveys. First one is the Industrial Outlook Survey calculated by RBI. And next one is the Annual Survey of Industries, which is conducted yearly once. So, the Industrial Outlook Survey is based on sampling method. Next one, the Annual Survey of Industries, being an annual exercise, was extrapolated using Index of Industrial Production to calculate value addition in the intervening period to publish quarterly estimation. See what happened? This Annual Survey of Industries was extrapolated by using the value of Index of Industrial Production also. Okay. So, Index of Industrial Production calculates the growth in major industries. So, with the help of this, so the value of Annual Survey of Industries was extrapolated. And then now what is happening? But now for incorporated sectors, we already know what is an incorporated sector. Along with IIP data, the MCA 21 data is also being used. So, we have IIP data plus the MCA 21 data. Fine. So, with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs making it obligatory on the part of the companies registered under the Companies Act for online reporting, the MCA 21 database has been used for the manufacturing sector value addition data. See, this MCA 21 data is very, very important because it is an initiative of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So, this is an online data. So, all the manufacturing units or the manufacturing companies should report about their company online. Okay. So, under this, the MCA database as on date covers 5 lakh companies. So, it takes into the database of how many companies? 5 lakh companies as of now. So, it captures the data on value addition completely rather than capturing sample data. So, each time when the value is added to each product, that will be calculated under the MCA 21. So, the MCA 21 is the e-governance initiative of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So, as of now, this MCA 21 is the e-governance initiative of Corporate Affairs. As of now, both IIP and MCA 21 is used for the calculation of GDP. Okay. So, you have to know about the GDP deflator, that is the nominal GDP divided by the real GDP into 100, how we estimated the national income before independence, and after independence, how are we estimating using Index of Industrial Production and using what? MCA 21 database. So, next coming to the related terms, under this we have the Index of Industrial Production, that is IIP. So, IIP measures the growth of industrial production in India. So, under IIP, we have three subheadings, that is we have three main industrial units, that is the mining, manufacturing and electricity. So, this is a previous year UPSC question. See to it which one has the highest weightage and which one has the lowest weightage. It keeps changing according to the current affairs. Fine. So, this IIP is calculated by Central Statistical Office and the base year for IIP is 2011-12. Next, moving to the Purchasing Managers Index or the PMI. Under this, PMI is published by Nikkei. Nikkei is a Japanese firm, but it is compiled by IHS Market Economics. So, this is a US based firm. Okay. So, this Purchasing Managers Index calculates the what? It calculates the level of industrial production in advance. So, before itself, it will calculate. Fine. So, what does the PMI do? So, under the PMI, It predicts the industrial production by tracking the following parameters. That is the new order flows. New order flows. Who are all placing the new orders in a company? Okay. Next one, coming to the output. How much output a company is giving? Next one, coming to the employment. How many people are employed in an economy? So next, coming to the stock of items. How many items a company is having stock? Okay. So these are all the parameters under the PMI, Purchasing Managers Index. So this is done by surveying purchasing executives over 400 manufacturing companies in India. So over here, 400 manufacturing companies, that too only the private companies are taken into account. Okay. Around 400 companies are being surveyed. Okay. So under here, the index above 50 reflects expansion and below 50 reflects contraction in the industrial production. So in this PMI index, if the value is above 50, then it means that the industries are growing, expansion is taking place. But if the value is below 50, it means that the industries are shrinking, contraction is taking place. Same way, like how we have for the manufacturing units, we have it for the services also. So over here, it is compiled by the IHS Market Economics. So service PMI predicts the level of service sectors output in advance. So same way, like how it predicts for goods, it predicts for services also. So please keep this in mind. It is for both goods and services. So with this, we come to the end of the lesson, National Income. And please subscribe to Get Into IAS and follow our Telegram channel link in the description box given below. Thank you for watching.